All right, welcome. Welcome to class number 5. It has been, there has been a hiatus of 3 weeks between class number 4 and class number 5. And today what I intend to review is what I will call the law and ethics of corporate governance. So what I have actually done is I have prepared two short lectures. One is I'll look on the legal side of corporate governance. And what I mean by that are just the different types of business entities, the different ways of doing business. I took us back to 2012 with our introductory song, when Facebook became a publicly traded corporation. But we'll see that Facebook actually transmogrified, from various different types of business entities. And so it's a great way, it's a great case study for learning about business formalities and business formation from the legal perspective. And we'll just cover here the big picture. Then in the second part of today's lecture, what I want to do is talk about the ethics of corporate governance. Above and beyond what the law says, what should business firms do? What is their corporate social responsibility? And as part of that second part of the lecture, I'll talk briefly about a bill that was recently introduced into Congress by Senator Elizabeth Warren and on the House side, I believe Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez is a big supporter. I'll talk about the Accountable Capitalism Act and how if that bill were to become enacted into law, basically, everything we're about to talk about in this class would become obsolete. It would just change business law overnight in very significant ways. They'll all allow yourself to judge whether the changes are for the better or for the worse, or whether it's simply just unpredictable to try to guess what would happen if that bill were to become enacted. So we're actually going to cover a lot of stuff today. And what I'm going to do is, I think to guide us through, I have opened the module, but I think to guide us through, I prepared two separate short lecture presentations. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and do a screen share. This should be ready now, yes. And this should make it a little bit easier to follow along with what I'm talking about. And let me just go to slideshow. Let's see where that is. Okay, it's over here. So I could make this, great. Great, so we'll talk about, this will be part one of corporate governance where we look at the legal side. And what I wanna just say off the bat, this is the big point. And this is what the Accountable Capitalism Act, if it were to be enacted, it's a long shot, but if it were to be enacted, would change. Right now, regardless of whether you're Facebook, a big or Google or Amazon or Apple, a big publicly traded corporation, or whether you're a private, quote unquote, mom and pop shop, limited liability company, sole proprietorship, we'll see these things. All business entities are, as of today, since time immemorial, are creatures of state law. And so what we'll be talking about is a state law. A lot of this is common law. Some of it is via statute and legislation. But let's go ahead and jump in. This cover page here, or this initial slide, is, I believe, from Wired, when they featured Mark Zuckerberg, when the company went public and when Facebook was still a popular company. What's interesting, you can see here, by the way, I've included, let's say, stock certificate, sample stock certificate, although most of this stuff is now traded electronically, but that's what a stock certificate would look like. And I just want to begin off the bat, again, just emphasizing how remarkable it is that a college dropout went on to become the CEO of really one of the most important companies, in the world. And to the extent, I know Facebook is no longer popular, and probably for a good reason. I myself have dropped Facebook during this Lent season. But I'll say this, if you use Instagram, you are a Facebook customer. You are, you're using one of Facebook's platforms. So let's go ahead and just jump in and look at not so much, legal issues that might affect Facebook's operations, as we've been doing contracts, property, torts, cybercrime, but let's look at the business entity. And what I've done here is I've created a kind of a big picture here of the different forms of doing business, big types of business entities. This is one of the reasons why I love Facebook as a way of organizing the class. And, assigning the social network, if you pay close attention to the dialogue and the deposition testimony, you're going to see that Facebook actually embodies all the major forms of doing business. At one point, and we'll talk about that today, it was a sole proprietorship. Then, when Eduardo comes into the picture at Mark's own invitation, it was a partnership, general partnership. Then it became a limited liability company registered here in the state of Florida. And then it went on to become a privately owned Delaware corporation. And now today, as of 2012, it is a publicly traded, very important, company. So let's go ahead and just jump in. And what I'm going to do in this first part of the lecture is give you the big picture of each one of these different ways of doing businesses, of doing business, I'm sorry. And what I'll do is, to make it practical and enjoyable, I'll really focus on the advantages and disadvantages of each of these types of ways of doing business. And so let's begin. Oh, and by the way, what I'm going to be talking about is relevant not just to Facebook. Think of your favorite company. This map, I love this map because it incorporates, just building on our previous lecture, law of ideas and trademark law. It builds on some of the most famous companies in our country. The states from which they originated. And here you see those famous trademarks. And you can see that, each of these companies have to decide, in addition to, okay, what product, what service am I going to offer to the public? What's my business model? There's also going to be a legal aspect to this. What we really mean by legal environment, not just legal liability issues, how do I protect my ideas and intellectual property as well? How do I avoid legal liability, but also how do I do business? How do I structure my business? How do I protect the investors of the business? And so that's what we'll talk about today. And we're going to see there's many different ways. It turns out the most common way of doing business, many of you, in fact, I would not be surprised at all if you are sole proprietors. That is to say, maybe you sell stuff on Etsy or eBay. Or maybe when you were younger, you maybe helped with landscaping, or, you had your own lemonade stand or whatever. The sole proprietorship. This is a really probably the simplest of and the most common of all the different ways of doing business. I throw Mark Zuckerberg in here because, like, when he was doing FaceMash, and when he was doing a lot of the other remarkable things that he did at Harvard, course match, and all these websites, when he was helping the as part of his apology for FaceMash, he actually helped design and build the website, the web page for the Association of Harvard Black Women, AHBW. And so, in a way, he's just operating as a sole proprietor, just doing stuff on his own. Now, granted, in Zuckerberg's case, because he identifies as a hacker, he's not doing any of this stuff for money. You know what I mean? But a lot of people, you got to make ends meet, people might be willing to pay you. And that's what a sole proprietor is, when you own and operate your own business. Now, the thing about a sole proprietorship is there's no legal formalities. It's just you go into business, you sell what you're selling, you provide the service you're providing. And now you may have to file some paperwork in the county in which you're doing business, maybe a doing business as. This, for example, in Florida may vary depending on what county you're in for sales tax purposes, so that the tax collector can verify that the sole proprietorship is paying its fair share of sales taxes on sales. But other than that, there's no formal format. There's no real formality. In a way, we're all sole proprietors. Now, the thing about sole proprietorships is that although it's the most common form of doing business, because there's really no formality involved, there are really a whole series of disadvantages. This is good, like maybe for, you know, a one-time or a small operation, but it has a lot of disadvantages in that one is because there's just one business owner, you know, unless you bring in partners or restructure as a limited liability company or a corporation, you can't really bring in other equity investors. You know, maybe you could take out a personal loan, you know, which you would have to personally guarantee, but it's, you know, maybe you can get loans from family and friends, but it's really hard to for capitalization to get, you know, raise money. You're just one person, you know, it's unstable. What I mean by that is as soon as the sole proprietor dies, the business is done from a legal point of view. Now there may be a will, there may be heirs, but that's it. The business is gone. Unbalanced management, all that refers to is that unlike a corporation, we have a board of directors, a bunch of officers, or a limited liability company where you might appoint a manager, or a partnership where you might have general partners with experience. A sole proprietorship is one guy or one girl running the show. And, you know, they may or may not have experience. You know, they may have advice from other people, but it's not really a formal structure. But the biggest disadvantage is this middle flag here, unlimited liability. That is to say, the sole proprietor, this owner, is going to be personally liable for all of the unpaid debts and legal liabilities of the sole proprietorship. This becomes a problem if you're, if you get sued, because now you are personally on the hook. The way we can describe this is that a sole proprietorship and from a common law perspective, has no separate legal existence from the business owner. So that's why when the business owner dies, the sole proprietorship it no longer exists. And that is why the sole proprietor, the owner, whoever he or she may be, is going to be personally liable, you know, for all of the debts and liabilities of the proprietorship. So although this is very common because there's no formalities, it has all of these structural disadvantages. And this is one of the reasons why it's no surprise that not just Mark Zuckerberg teams up with Eduardo, you know, his best friend, but a lot of the most famous companies, like whether we're talking about Google, began as a partnership between Sergey Brin and Larry Page. Apple, most famously, right? The two Steves, Jobs and Wozniak, right? A lot of businesses, Twitter, Microsoft, Bill Gates, Paul Allen, you know, begin as partnerships among two or more friends. And the basic idea is when you have a common venture, a common enterprise, and you have the partners contributing either their knowledge, money, contacts, whatever, to the venture, you have a general partnership. Again, there is no formal legal filing. Now, ideally, lawyers will tell you want to have a business, you want to have a partnership agreement in writing. But as we already saw with the common law, contracts don't have to be necessarily in writing, right? Unless they fall into one of the categories under the UCC sale of goods or the statute of frauds. So a partnership, generally speaking, right, like Eduardo and Zuckerberg is the best example. And I've included a link to the scene of the Caribbean night party in which, dramatizing the partnership between Eduardo and Zuckerberg. In reality, I'll let you know that that partnership actually was formed at a pizzeria in Cambridge in Harvard Square. I believe it's called Cambridge One. And it's the pizzeria still there. And that's where they became partners. And even though it's all verbal, right, we saw that as long as it's for a lawful purpose, and the partners have legal capacity. And, you know, it's a voluntary agreement, this offer and acceptance, et cetera, et cetera. It's going to be a legally enforceable contract. And we'll see, this will be the heart of the lawsuit, as we'll see in our last module, in our last class on April 6th. So we'll talk more about that, and that's going to be a real big headache for Zuckerberg later on. But partnerships, you know, the idea here is you want to bring in a team of people, you know, and each have, you know, can each bring different attributes and different advantages, you know, to the business firm. So partnerships, and by the way, partnerships go all the way back to Roman law. There's a big history. Now, if you want to form what's called a limited partnership, there will be a formal filing. I think it's called the statement of qualification that you got to file with the Department of State in one of the 50 states, depending on where you're doing business. But a general partnership, this is common law. And I have here the two key points I want you to know about partnerships. One is that, again, like a sole proprietorship, it's going to be unlimited liability, but in a way it's worse because you're going to have two or more partners. At common law, going back to Roman law, unless it's a limited partnership, if it's a general partnership, all the partners are, and this is the magic term, jointly and severally liable for each other's acts. And I kind of break that down, you know, the technical aspects of that in the next slide. But all you need to know is that what that means is, go back to Eduardo and Mark Zuckerberg, right? Zuckerberg is the one who's being sued, right? For stealing the idea, breaching contracts, fraud, et cetera, et cetera. But guess what? Eduardo, as Mark's partner, Eduardo is also legally liable. They're jointly and severally liable. And guess what? This is significant because, you know, Eduardo, remember, if you saw the movie, you know, if you paid close attention to the movie or you read the book on which it's based, Eduardo made a killing the summer of his sophomore year when he invested in a bunch of oil futures in the Brazilian oil market. And he actually has a lot of money in his bank account, over $100,000. So, you know, that's one of the big disadvantages of a partnership, that all the partners are liable to each other's, you know, for their, you know, if they get sued and you know, misconduct is proven. The other thing is that partners owe each other, like what's called fiduciary duties. That is to say, above and beyond what's in the partnership agreement, or even if there is no partnership contract or just an informal verbal agreement like Eduardo and Mark had, you have to, and here I've broken it down, you know, to all the different components of what I mean by a fight. That's why it's fiduciary duties, plural. All this is common law. You've got to act with the utmost respect with your fellow partners. And you've got to respect, you know, any confidential information. You can't share that outside of the partnership. You got to obey whatever you agree to as partners. You have to keep your word. Accountability, if you're making any income separate from the partnership, you've got to report that to your fellow partners so they can make sure that you're being, that's part of the duty of loyalty. You can't have any conflict of interests. Sometimes you see this, for example, in the last Shark Tank, there were a couple of Latin girls that had a really great idea for some kind of cosmetic products, but Alex Rodriguez, and I believe one of the other sharks, they already had an investment in cosmetic company. So they, you know, the duty of loyalty will prevent them from investing in another company. You know, without disclosing it and getting the permission of their partners. Duty of care, you have to act reasonably in the best interest of the partners and the partnership. So this is a really, we saw this in fact, because Zuckerberg is sued for breach of fiduciary duties, as we saw when we looked at the common law, but all this is common law, state law. Now, this all goes back to Roman law. If, you know, when there's a fiduciary relationship, that means there has to be trust among the partners, and you have to really act not just in your own best interest, like we're used to in a capitalist system, you know, but you have to act in the best interest of your fellow partners and the partnership. That's what it boils down to. And that can create legal liabilities. In fact, Mark and Eduardo, as we'll see in our last class, they're going to sue each other for breach of fiduciary duties. And that's going to be the heart of their lawsuits against each other. With joint and several liability, all I want you to know is that that means all of the partners can be sued individually, and whoever has the most money, the defendant, can recover against any of the defendants. You don't have to go after all of them. That's what I mean by joint and several liability. So what I'll do now, though, is I want to focus on, and I've included in the module, the actual articles of organization when Facebook registered as a limited liability company. One of the things Eduardo did, and check out the date, it's April 2004, right? Eduardo's no dummy. He realizes that, hey, as Mark's partner, you know, I'm going to be jointly and severally liable for anything that Mark is accused of, you know? And so what I want to do is by creating a limited liability company, those are, and doing it here in Florida. Now, they could have done it in any one of the 50 states. You know, they could have done it in California. They could have done it in, you know, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. They could have done it, you know, in Alaska. But that's one of the great, that's why I say that business entities are a creature of state law. You have to pick, you have to register in one and only one state. And then because of the full faith and credit clause in Article 4 of the Constitution, all the other 49 states and the District of Columbia and Puerto Rico and the territories have to respect that. Now, for whatever reason, Eduardo, you know, is from Coral Gables, grew up there, really from Brazil, but he grew up in Coral Gables. A lot of us can identify. My family are immigrants as well. So I, you know, so he said, hey, I'm gonna, I grew up in Florida. Let me just do this in Florida. You know, Florida, we don't have any personal income tax. You know, we have a very pro-business friendly state. So I'm gonna register the Facebook limited liability company here in Florida. So I think that's pretty cool. And you can see the articles of organization and what it takes. And you can see it's a one-page document plus the cover sheet and the signature page. So it's a really simple, now there is a filing, you know, unlike general partnerships and sole proprietorships, there is a filing for limited liability companies, but it's a one-page thing and it's a modest fee. Last time I checked at sunbiz.org, you know, the Department of Florida Department of State, I think it was $225, you know? But the main thing is now you get limited liability. Now the owners of the LLC, the owners of the business firm are not going to be personally liable, you know? Now also, if I can go back here, now you can create a stable management team, you know? You can bring in, for example, Dustin Moskovitz, who by the way is from Ocala, Florida, and who did a lot of the early work in helping expand Facebook into Columbia University, Yale College, and Stanford. Limited source of capital. Now you can require, as a condition of, you know, joining the LLC, you got to invest in the LLC. And now you've dealt with the unstable existence problem. Under Florida law, an LLC will last for 40 years. Now this will vary state by state, but basically you got, you know, several decades of existence. And generally speaking, as long as you're in business, you can even renew your limited liability company charter, you know? So it's, you've dealt with all of those problems with, sole proprietorships, and you've dealt with the joint and several liability problem that partnerships have. The other advantage, by the way, of a limited I'll tell you all the advantages. Let me just say really quickly, there are two types of limited liability companies, so-called manager-managed or manager-operated and member-operated or member-managed, kind of a tongue twister. What it means, like, for example, the Facebook LLC was member-managed. The three members who are identified on the articles of organization in that Module E document I've included, they're all going to operate, you know, they're all going to basically be directly involved in the day-to-day operations of the limited liability company. But one of the advantages of a limited liability company is that the members could appoint a manager, a professional, and pay him or her, or give him or her an equity stake to operate the business on their behalf. So that's why sometimes when we talk about limited liability companies, we'll talk about managers and members, depending on the type of LLC it is. And both are perfectly fine, depending on what it is. You know, whether you yourself as an owner want to operate your own LLC, or whether you want to pay somebody else, appoint somebody else to operate the LLC for you, you know. But in both cases, the owners, right, the members of the LLC, as they're known, get limited legal liability. They're not going to be personally liable for the debts and liabilities of the LLC. That's a huge advantage. Now you can sort of breathe a sigh of relief. Now, of course, the limited liability company will be legally liable for its debts and liabilities, but not the owners, not the members or the manager. Now, here, this chart, I really love circles, I love geometry, and I love color. So this chart is one of my favorite of the entire semester. It may look like a lot of information and you may not like it as much as I do, but what's really cool about the chart, in addition to the visualization of it, is it just goes over all of the advantages of an LLC. One is you can have single member LLCs. That is to say, even if you are a sole proprietor, you can get the benefit of limited legal liability as long as you file the articles of organization and pay the fee and do all the formalities that are required of an LLC, you know? Now, I'll tell you as a piece of advice, you have to keep your personal finances and the finances of the LLC. You have to keep that completely separate. Like in The Social Network, when Eduardo opens up the bank account for the Facebook LLC, right? That scene where they're having the hackathon and they're choosing who's going to be the interns. It's critical that Eduardo, the movie doesn't really tell you this, but it's critical that Eduardo, when he goes to Bank of America, open up the bank account, that he open it up, not in Eduardo's name or Mark's name or both of their names or Dustin's name, right? But he open it up in the name of the Facebook LLC. So for that, he's going to have to show a copy, that document I've included in Module 8E. He'll have to include show a copy to the bank of the articles of organization, the filing statement, you know, the confirmation from the Department of State, and then he can open the bank account on behalf of the limited liability company and keep those finances separate. That's really important, because if you don't do that, then guess what? You're not going to enjoy the protection of limited liability. Courts will do they will pierce the corporate veil. They will go directly after, they'll allow the plaintiff or whoever's ever suing for damages, you know, whatever. They'll allow whoever's trying to collect on a debt, you know, they'll allow them to sue the owners, the members of the LLC directly, if they don't have their, you know, legal formalities in place and separate bank accounts. The other thing is pass-through taxation. As a limited liability company, in consultation with your accountant, it might make sense to be, you decide how you want to be taxed. Maybe you just want to pass whatever money the LLC makes. You just want to, report that on your individual tax report, like you would if you were a sole proprietor, you know? Or if, like, you're in the state of Florida and you have a very favorable business climate and a very favorable business tax regime, maybe you want to be taxed as a corporation. And so you get to decide. It's flexible. But again, you do that in consultation. We won't go into the details here. That'll be the upper level course. But I want to let you know that you got that flexibility. A lot less paperwork than doing a corporation. Yes, there's more paperwork than doing a partnership or sole proprietorship, because those don't require filings, but it's one page. That's it. You know, look at the Facebook LLC filing. Now, I will tell you, lawyers will recommend if there's two or more owners of the LLC, they should also have an operating agreement that will set forth, you know, the rules of the game. What happens, you know, if somebody wants to buy the other partner out, the other member out? What happens if somebody maybe dies, you know? What happens if who decides if there's a tie, you know, who gets to vote, those kind of things. So an operating agreement, you don't file that with the Department of State, but you should also have an operating agreement. But you're not required. There's a limited, you know, very little formalities. All you need are the articles of organization, a one-page document. As we saw, the purple LLC is the one that's legally liable for debts and liabilities, not the owners, not the members, not the manager. And that blends into the red. Why? Because the limited liability company, unlike a partnership or unlike a sole proprietorship, the limited liability company is a separate legal entity, separate from the owners. And finally, management, like I said, you could designate a manager to run the LLC for you. You're not required to, but you have that flexibility. So there's a really lot of advantages with limited liability company. And for small up and coming companies, even sole proprietorships, you know, it's, you know, think about it, you know, it's, there is a fee, right? There are some formalities, but what are you getting in return? You got to have separate bank accounts, but you're getting limited legal liability. You're getting that protection. You're getting that peace of mind as an owner of the business firm. So that's the third major way of doing business beyond partnerships and sole proprietorships. Finally, now we come back, you know, to Facebook in the present time, the corporation. And there's a great scene in the movie. I'll try to also include that in the module E, where Peter Thiel, or someone playing the role of Peter Thiel, says, congratulations, Mark. You know, this is when Mark and Jesse Eisenberg and Justin Timberlake go up through this building in San Francisco, and they're going to meet with Peter Thiel, you know, and Peter Thiel goes, yeah, congratulations, I'm going to hook you up with a $500,000 angel investment, but we're going to have to reorganize your company from a limited liability company into a corporation. Why is that? Because, you know, limited liability company already has the advantage of limited liability, right? You don't have all the paperwork that a corporation will require. Why does, so here's the question I want to address this last part of the, of this part one of the lecture. Why does Peter Thiel want Facebook to become a corporation? What are the advantages of being a corporation? And why in real life, as in the movie, why does he insist that it become a Delaware corporation when Facebook really has no connection to Delaware? You know, maybe, you know, maybe by, you know, summer of 2005, you know, the University of Delaware is now on the Facebook, you know, but, you know, there's no other connection, right? It's a California company that was founded in Harvard, right? In Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Why? Well, let me address the why I become a corporation. And here I have, for example, again, that sample Facebook stock certificate. Here are some pictures of the member of the board of directors. If you want to see the current board, and here's Peter Thiel, for example. Here's Mark Andreessen, founder of Netscape, Zuckerberg and Sheryl Sandberg on the board. A couple of other people are on the board as well. And then I have, for example, Sean Parker there, the real Sean Parker, not Justin Timberlake, who was Facebook's first president, one of the first officers of the Facebook, or Facebook back then, they dropped the. What it is with the corporation, what you do is the owners are the shareholders, and the shareholders elect the board of directors, and then the board of directors elect or appoint the officers. In other words, the way we look at this, the way lawyers talk about this, is that what the corporation does, it separates ownership and control. The shareholders are the nominal or legal owners of the business entity, but the directors, you know, and the officers, they actually operate, run, manage the corporation and the business affairs of the company. The directors basically set general policy, monitor, stuff like that. And they appoint off, you know, they meet like maybe, you know, once in a while. The shareholders have to meet at least once a year based on, you know, state law. And the officers, they're the ones that are running the company on a day-by-day basis. That's the management team. By the way, Zuckerberg and Sheryl Sandberg are not only members of the board of directors, but they're also officers, right? A board of directors has appointed them to be the chief executive officer and chief operating officer, respectively, of the Facebook Inc. today. So this is what's really the main advantage of a corporation, you know, the corporate entity. If you plan to go big, if you plan to bring in new investors, this is the best way to go. Because what you do is, instead of amending your articles of organization and bringing in new members or new partners if you're a partnership, all you do is you sell new shares. Now, there are more details in, I believe it's chapter 15 of the textbook. What I want you to know, though, for purposes of this class, are really keep in mind there's two types of corporations, privately held and publicly held, or you could call it for short, private corporations and public corporations. Now, both are privately owned. You know, that doesn't mean that the government owns a publicly held. No, not at all. What it means is that a privately held company, and I give you some examples of two of my favorite companies, Publix, In-N-Out, Chick-fil-A as well. These are companies that they're owned by the shareholders, but the stocks, you know, usually it's a family group. The shareholders are family groups, or maybe people who marry into the family, or in the case of Publix, the employees. But the stocks are not sold on the secondary stock market. You know, you can't buy shares of Publix, you know, on the New York Stock Exchange, for example. Only a small group of people, or in the case of Publix, you know, the employees who have sufficient time and qualify to own shares in their company. That's what I mean by privately owned. On the West Coast, you have In-N-Out Burger, it's owned by a family, you know, privately owned. It's also sometimes called a close corporation, in that it's a small number of shareholders, you know, and the stocks are not, you know, you just can't buy them on the stock exchange. And in fact, usually there'll be a shareholder agreement listing the conditions when a shareholder may sell to an outsider. Usually there's going to be a right of first refusal so that the other shareholders in the privately owned company can buy those shares. And Facebook, by the way, began as a privately held company when Peter Thiel, you know, converted it into a Delaware corporation in 2005. Then in 2012, I played some party rock anthem song. 2012, Facebook goes public, $40 a share. Today it's at now today at the close of the closing bell, NASDAQ, it's at $290 a share, way up from that initial $253 per share at the beginning of the semester, And so publicly held, right, you have lots of shareholders, right? Usually not even thousands, millions, and the shares are traded on a secondary market. And anybody, if you have the money, you can go buy the shares, And so Google or Alphabet Inc. is another, great example of a publicly held company. But guess what? Both types of companies have that same structure, except that in a closed corporation or a privately held corporation, usually the shareholders are the members of the board, Usually the members of the board of directors, they're the shareholders, they own their own company. And then what they're doing is, as the company grows, they might be offering what's called a Series A, Series B. They might be bringing in venture capital firms to join as shareholders. But again, it's a small number, ultimately, then the idea is to go public, Uber is another example of companies that, hey, let's go public. Twitter, let's go on the stock exchange. Let's go on the NASDAQ. Let's go on the NYSE, Now, the other question is, why Delaware? Why is Delaware so special, right? What is it about? And by the way, it's not just Facebook. Take a look at this image here on your left, By the way, it's like over, 50% of all Fortune 500 companies around the world are incorporated as Delaware corporations. And more than 60% of companies traded on the New York Stock Exchange are also Delaware corporations. So it's not just Facebook. And this is just remarkable. It doesn't really matter what business you're in. Google is incorporated in Delaware, even though it's a California company. Levi's, right? The famous blue jeans, right? Even though they, founded in San Francisco, they're a Delaware company. Coca-Cola, right? Atlanta, Georgia, but they're a Delaware company, legally speaking. Walmart, Home Depot, all of these companies, Ford Motor Company and General Motors, right? You think they're Michigan? No, they're Delaware. I could go on and on. A lot of banks, a lot of investment banks, the Barnes and Noble bookstore, we go on and on, So what is it so special about Delaware? And ultimately, what's so special about Delaware is two things. And let me see if they'll let me get to the arrow here. Oops, I went backwards. I need to go forward. Delaware's motto is that they're the first state. And the reason why they call themselves the first state, like on their license plates and on their commemorative quarters and on their billboards and promotional, brochures and stuff like that, is because Delaware was, by the way, they were the first state to ratify the United States Constitution back in 1787. So it's, pretty cool history. But also, Delaware was the first state to adopt a general corporation law. What we take for granted today is that back in the day, hundreds of years ago, if you wanted to have limited legal liability for your investors, if you wanted to create what's called a joint stock company, you generally had to get, if you're in England, you had to get a royal charter. You had to basically be friends with the king or Queen Elizabeth, the first, whoever is in power at the time. If you're in the US, either pre-colonial, before the revolution or after the revolution, but before Delaware enacts the new law, you would have to get a charter, an authorization from the state legislature. Suffice it to say, that just led to a lot of corruption, right? How are you gonna get a bunch of politicians to approve your petition to become a corporation, without having all the connections and, paying out people, So Delaware said, no, we're going to get rid of this corruption. One of the great moments in business history. Delaware says, what we're going to do? as long as you pay the fee and file your articles of incorporation and your bylaws with the Department of State and you pay the fee, guess what? Anybody can be a corporation. You don't need special permission from the legislature, from the people in power. So it's actually a very important thing. Now, the other reason that Delaware continues to be the leading state when it comes to corporate law and, you know, business incorporation. Remember, I said all business firms in the U.S. are creatures of state law, and most of them prefer Delaware, is because Delaware, in addition to having this long storied history and this great general corporation law that, by the way, most of the other states have basically copied, plagiarized in some cases. But guess what? Delaware has another advantage that they keep to the state. They have a special business law court called the Court of Chancery. And what makes it so special is two things. One, it's what we call, what lawyers call in court of equity. That means there's no jury. That is to say, you don't have to, and we'll see this, this will be a segue to the next last class on April 6th when we look at, you know, civil and criminal cases. You know, juries just add a lot of uncertainty when somebody has to go to court. And so with the Court of Chancery, you're gonna have judges, or what they're called chancellors, but they're judges deciding business law disputes. And it's more predictable or less unpredictable. The other big advantage, and here I have some bonus slides, I won't go into all of them, but I'll talk about the business judgment rule, is this is gonna be relevant when Eduardo's gonna wanna sue Mark Zuckerberg, you know, or when any shareholder wants to sue the company because the board of directors made a bad business decision. The business judgment rule says, guess what? We, the courts of Delaware, we're not going to allow you to sue a company if the members of the board, if the board of directors can show that when they made a decision, you know, they acted in good faith and they acted in the best interest of the company, you know, based on the relevant information at the time. We're not going to, we, the courts of Delaware, Chancery Court, we're not going to second guess business decisions. We're not going to make, we're not going to allow shareholders to sue company. I mean, shareholders can sue companies. It's called a derivative action. When the board members of the board of directors or when the officers breach their fiduciary duties that we talked about earlier, that partners have, members of the board of directors and officers also have a fiduciary duty to the shareholders to act in their best interest. But in Delaware, it's very hard to sue to enforce these fiduciary duties because the Chancery Court gives the Delaware corporations, they will give them the benefit of the doubt, basically, just to put it, you know, in plain English, you know? It's basically gonna be up to the shareholder to prove that, like, for example, when Eduardo gets diluted, as we'll see in the next class, he's gonna have to prove that Zuckerberg acted in bad faith and was not acting on the basis of reasonable information and not in the best interest of Facebook. When, you know, of course, Zuckerberg is gonna tell a different story. And the courts are gonna say, well, you know what? As long as Zuckerberg can bring in some evidence that he was acting on an informed basis when he diluted Eduardo and was acting in good faith for the best, goal of the company, best interest of the company, we're going to give Zuckerberg and the board of directors, you know, Peter Thiel, you know, all we're going to give them the benefit of the doubt. So that's why Peter Thiel insists on, you know, changing the Facebook from a limited liability company to a, not just any old corporation of any old state like California or Massachusetts, but a Delaware corporation to get the benefit of the business judgment rule and to get judges to apply the business judgment rule and not juries that are a big wild card. And so that's just in a nutshell. There are other things that the Delaware courts have developed, you know, the piercing the corporate veil and the idea of fiduciary duties. There are other types of fiduciary relationships above and beyond the business context. Like of those of you studying accounting or wanting to go to law school, you know, lawyers and accountants are, or, you know, financial advisors as well, those of you in finance, you are fiduciaries of your clients. You have a trust relationship. So I have a couple of bonus slides there. Now, if you allow me, I will go ahead and, but this is what I want you to know for the class, the business judgment rule. It's something that was pioneered by the Delaware Chancery Court. And guess what? If you are a Delaware corporation, it doesn't matter where you're sued. The courts of the state in which you're sued have to apply Delaware law, you know, when it's a Delaware corporation involved in the lawsuit. So this is really the why Delaware is so special from a corporate point of view. Now, we've seen the major forms of doing business. And the advantages and disadvantages of each. Really, you want to be a corporation if you do plan to eventually go public. You know what I mean? That is to say, you know, have a bunch of investors go on the New York Stock Exchange or NASDAQ or the Nisei and, you know, Tokyo or whatever, you know, Hong Kong. You know, if you're just, you know, if you just want limited liability protection, but you don't plan to grow so quickly, you know, just a LLC is perfectly fine, you know, including a single member LLC. But what I want to do, that's the law. And what the law tells us is that whether you're a sole proprietor or a partner in a partnership or a member or manager of a limited liability company or a director or officer of a corporation, you have fiduciary duties. You have to act in the best interest of the partners, of the fellow owners, members, of the you know, of the shareholders if it's a corporation. But what about ethically? What should you do? What about, do businesses have a deeper corporate social responsibility? And because we're talking here about legal and ethical environment of business, I now, in the second part of the class, I want to talk about sort of the ethics of corporate governance, and I want to present to you two major schools of thought. You know, each have some advantages and disadvantages as well. And then I'll conclude with some pending legislation, the Accountable Capitalism Act, that basically would make everything that I've taught you so far would make it completely obsolete. So let's go ahead and talk about all of these things. So what I will do first and foremost is I will pull up, if you'll just give me the indulgence, I will pull up the second slide presentation. Just to avoid confusion, I want to make it clear to my students that we're now going to ethics. So the first, you know, first thing is, what can businesses do, right? Depending whether they're a corporation, a partnership, or a limited legal company, or a sole proprietorship. Now, ethically, what should they do? And so let's go ahead and do the screen share for the second part here. And I'm going to go ahead and jump in here and pull this up and then do the slideshow so you can see this. See this in greater detail. I also get a swig of Coke here, Coca-Cola, just so I can repower up for the second part of the class. Now, there are a lot of different ways of teaching this, you know, but I'm gonna simplify it. You know, we only have limited time. You know, if you're like me, you wanna go to the beach, you got other classes you gotta work with or other projects you're doing, you know, so let's just boil it down. Look, what it comes down to is there's really two big schools of thought. One and two, I'm gonna call it like that. You know, the number one is the so-called Friedman Doctrine, named after the great economist, Chicago economist, Nobel laureate Milton Friedman, that your goal is to, now there are two ways of saying, that's why it can get a little bit more complicated. You know, Friedman famously said that the social responsibility of business is to expand its, increase its profits, you know? But he also made it clear that it's gotta be, you know, within the rules of the game. You can't break the law, you can't commit fraud, breach of contract, you know. As long as you play by the rules, your social responsibility is only to make money. You know, it's called the Friedman Doctrine. That may not sound like an ethical doctrine, but it is, because the idea is, you're, you know, what Friedman is saying, and again, I'm not gonna, you know, say this right or wrong, that's for each of us to decide, but what Friedman is saying in his defense, what he's saying is that, the ethical obligation of a company is just to obey the law, you know? Above and beyond that, it doesn't, you know, the ethical obligation is to make money on behalf of the shareholder, you know, expand shareholder value, if you want to use the modern jargon. And I know when I say maximizing profits, you know, that has a lot of ambiguity, you know, what, you know, what's the time frame? What are we talking about profits or revenues? You know, we get all those. I don't want to go into all those little details. I just want to give you the big picture, right? The second school of thought, often it's called a corporate citizenship or the stakeholder model, is basically you got to act not just in the best interest of the shareholders of the corporation, but you also have to act, you know, in the best interest of all of your stakeholders, all the people that your company interacts with. So this is an interesting question that you may want to think about at home. What do you think Facebook does? You know, what do you think Zuckerberg does? Is, you know, I'm not asking you what he says he does. I'm asking you what the company actually does. You know, are they just about maximizing profits, or are they about, you know, being a good corporate citizen and, you know, taking into account all of the stakeholders, not just the shareholders. Well, let me describe in more detail what both of these theories are to give you, you know, make it that short, you know. I'll talk about the Friedman Doctrine, which is the profit max model, as I just summarize it, which by the way, it has, let me be the advocate here. It has a storied history. It's not just Milton Friedman. It really goes back. And Milton Friedman, by the way, probably the smartest economist of the, you know, one of the smartest of the 20th century, along with Paul Samuelson and Ronald Coase, and those of you in economics know who I'm talking about. But this goes back to Adam Smith, where, you know, the invisible hand theory, you know, that you basically, if everybody pursues their self-interest, that's what's going to benefit society overall, you know? So, you know, this has a powerful sort of intellectual history to it. And if you think about it, right, it's the fundamental premise of sort of what people like to call neoliberal economics or, you know, modern economics, you know what I mean? In distinction from, let's say, Marxist economics or other form heterodox economics, you know? But the basic idea is that then a company, you know, it's, and here's the key, it's an ethical vision of a company, that the company ethically is required to make money, because remember, the board of directors and the officers have a fiduciary duty to the shareholders, and you got to comply with the law. So as long as you're not committing fraud, as long as you're not committing antitrust violations and doing other bad things, which arguably Facebook may be doing, we'll see that in the last class. You know, as long as you're complying with the law, your ethical obligation is to make money. Now, I got to say, it's a very powerful history, you know, but this theory is kind of very easy to criticize. I could show you another slide with a lot of information, but I'm going to show you just a picture of a guy and just refute this sort of, you know, in one picture, you know, so-called pharma bro. Many of you may know this guy, bought out the Wu-Tang, you know, records, recordings, you know, and hoarded them, and then, you know, bought some pharmaceutical patents and then jacked up the price of to 5,000%, you know. So, you know, this guy is classic Friedman Doctrine, right? Classic profit maximizer, right? But yet he's one of the most unpopular men in America, businessmen in America, right? So it's kind of telling us, and if you don't mind me saying, it's kind of in defense of Adam Smith. Before he wrote The Wealth of Nations, he was actually a moral philosopher before he became an economist. And he wrote this really deep philosophy book called A Theory of Moral Sentiments, where he really says that, you know, before you can participate in the market and worry about your self-interest, you have to worry about other people as well, and that we are predisposed to care about what other people think of us and what we think of other people. And so Adam Smith, I'm just going to tell you, it's a shame that with this new format, I can't do a whole separate lecture on Adam Smith. I think the real Adam Smith is a much more complex and nuanced figure. I think the real Adam Smith would say that morality is essential before we can have a well-functioning market, you know, even before we have well-functioning laws. And that's why I spent so much time when I talked about sources of law, I spent a lot of time about natural law theories and various theories of ethics, you know, because I actually think, you know, I'm very much a big fan of what I call the real Adam Smith, the moral philosopher, who really does, you know, care about other people and would be completely aghast at this kind of behavior. So if we're going to criticize the profit max model, you know what I mean? And you could say this is an extreme professor, you know, but what's the alternative, right? And the alternative is, and again, this is just another model of corporate social responsibility, a competing model called the stakeholder model. Now, I've cut out a bunch of slides because we have this new format, I got to cram in a lot of information. But when you read a lot of corporate social responsibility mission statements, you know, a lot of it, I'm going to be honest with you, is wishy-washy, you know, it's like, what does this mean? Like Enron, you know, that famous company that completely imploded and just destroyed so many lives, the Arthur Andersen accounting firm was basically declared illegal for their aiding and abetting of criminal Enron activities. Enron had one of the best corporate social responsibility statements I've ever read. So let's, I think this has to be more than words, it's got to be action. And to me, the very powerful competing vision to the Friedman Doctrine, or the profit maximization / moral minimum model, is going to be the stakeholder model. And it's actually very simple. What I've done here is a visualization in that I've identified, think of Facebook, right? Who are the stakeholders? What do I mean by that? I mean that above and beyond the stockholders or the shareholders, right? You look at your employees, the people who work for you, and spend a lot, you know, most, you know, sacrifice for you so that your company can do what it does, right? Your suppliers, right? The people you do business with. Your creditors, you know, in addition to shareholders, Facebook will also have a lot of, you know, there'll be equity, but there'll also will be debt, right? And sometimes certain projects are financed through debt transactions. The local communities in which you do business. In the case of Facebook, that would be the entire world, right? With over 2 billion active users, right? But most importantly, your user base, the people, the customers, right? The people who use your product or use your service, right? So what the stakeholder model simply says is that when you make a business decision, you have to take into account not only what's in the best interest of your shareholders, right? The corporate owners, right? But you also at least at a minimum take into account your other stakeholders as well. You know what I mean? Starting with your employees, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Let me give you what I think is probably the most famous example of this to show you that this is actually, because I'm going to talk about later Senator Warren and AOC, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, who are very liberal, you know, liberal Democrats and all progressive. But let me tell you something. Donald Trump is actually a great example of the stakeholder model. I don't know if you remember the 2016 election campaign and when he became president, you know, president-elect and stuff like that back in 2016, he really called out Ford Motor Company and the Carrier Company in Indiana because they were going to close their factories and relocate or open new factories overseas, either in the People's Republic of China or in the Republic of Mexico or in other places. And so what Trump is basically saying, you know, and you probably don't want to see this guy anymore again, you know, or you might be a huge MAGA fan. But what Trump was basically saying, irrespective of your politics, is that, hey, companies, you know, it's not just about making money. It's about also, you know, considering your employees and the communities in which they live. Right. So that I just want to show you this is kind of a nonpartisan thing. Now, that said, as a professor, my job is to be a critical, you know, basically poke holes. You know, I'm also a lawyer. So my critique of the stakeholder model, though, I think it's a very attractive model. Don't get me wrong. You know, it's a very beautiful vision. Right. And it makes a lot of sense. Probably why Trump won the 2016 election, because he was willing to go to bat for, you know, blue collar workers. Right. But the problem is, though, from an analytical or intellectual perspective, this is a very wishy-washy model in that, look, I've read dozens of papers and books on this whole subject, you know, and I haven't heard a single individual, single scholar, single business person tell me what weights they assign to each of the stakeholders. Let's go back here. You know, are these equally weighted? Here, there's five different groups of stakeholders. Do they each get 20%? And then, you know, and the reason why I say that, you know, to me, it's actually important that we weight or assign some weights to each of these stakeholders, each of these stakeholder groups, is because what happens when their interests conflict or collide? You know, think of like Carrier actually is a great example of this, or Ford Motor Company. Yeah, the employees benefit if the Ford Motor Company and the Carrier Company Corporation, right, stay in the United States. But what about the customers, right? That may probably now have to pay a lot more money for their products because presumably, right, if you build stuff overseas, you know, it's going to be a competitive price advantage, you know, even after you factor in transportation costs and all that kind of stuff, right? So it's like, you know, so what happens? You know, I need to, in order to, you know, it's one thing when the interest of all of these groups point in the same direction, right? But when there are conflicts of interest among the stakeholders themselves, what do I do? You know, how do I make a decision, right? The profit maximization model has the advantage that I just ignore all of this. And I just look at how does this affect the bottom line? How does this affect my shareholders and shareholder value, right? The other problem is, you know, well, yeah, that basically sums it up. Let me conclude now on a pending piece of legislation called the Accountable Capitalism Act. This is what your discussion post is going to be about. And your opinion survey and all that stuff. Because what this bill would do is it would basically, like I said, it would make completely obsolete everything I've just told you about, you know, corporate ethics, you know, business ethics and, you know, business entity law. That's, you know, businesses are creatures of state law. Now, let me back up. What this bill would do And, you know, and I don't want to say it's a good bill or a bad bill. You know, I'm huge fans, you know, I'm not really that much into politics anymore, but I have to admit, you know, these are very charismatic, you know, politicians, leaders, right? And future of the Democratic Party. And they now have the majority in both houses. You know, when this bill was introduced, the Republicans controlled the Senate, but that's no longer true. So maybe this bill will get a hearing, right? Certainly we'll get a hearing in the House and probably will be approved in the House, you know, but what will happen in the Senate? The bill would do three things, but I want to make it very clear. The Accountable Capitalism Act, as it's currently drafted, only applies to companies like Facebook, Google, Apple, basically big Fortune 500 companies. It basically only applies to companies that have $1 billion or more in revenue each year. So it won't apply to most limited liability companies. It won't apply to most, you know, partner, small partnerships. It won't apply to sole proprietorships, right? Unless they're making more than $1 billion a year. Really, the only people making more than $1 billion a year, right, except for the drug cartels, are going to be these big Fortune 500 corporations, right? So what the bill does, it does three things that I want you to know about. And then you can decide for yourself whether this is a step in the right direction. What it would do is it would say, guess what, corporations? You're no longer only going to be a creature of state law. Yes, you have to file in Delaware or whatever of the states, whichever state you decide to incorporate, most likely Delaware. But also, you're going to have to register with a new federal agency. It's going to be called the United States Office of Corporations. And again, only companies with $1 billion or more in revenue will have to file, you know, register with the U.S. Office of Corporations. Why do they have to register? A lot of people say this is socialist, like that. It's not really socialist per se. What it is that this is the office that's going to have the power to enforce the law. So they need to know, you know, which of the companies are, you know, to enforce the law too. So there's going to be a new federal agency called the U.S. Office of Corporations. All companies with $1 billion or more in revenue, you know, per year will have to file. Obtain a charter from the U.S. Office of Corporations. It's the other two things that are a little bit dramatic and that would change existing, you know, would also change existing law. Right now, there is no U.S. Office of Corporations. What there is there's a Securities and Exchange Commission, right? SEC. That's, again, for an advanced class. What the SEC basically does is that if you're a publicly traded company, if you're on the NASDAQ like Facebook, or the New York Stock Exchange, like the other Fortune 500 companies, you got to file periodic disclosures with the federal government. You know, that's it. You know, you got to file what's called a 10K report. You know, you got to file a quarterly report. You got to file an annual report. You got to file disclosures telling your investors basically, how many, you know, lawsuits are pending against the company, what is the balance sheet of the company, what are the audited financial statements of the company, et cetera, et cetera. But you don't have to obtain any kind of a charter from the SEC. All you do is just comply with the disclosure requirements. This law, though, would require, again, big companies, whether they're publicly traded or private, you know, to obtain a charter at the U.S. Office of Corporations. And it would actually change the fiduciary duties. You know, fiduciary duties is common law, state law, and under existing Delaware law and the law of the other, you know, 49 states and the DC and Puerto Rico, you have a fiduciary duty if you're a corporation to your shareholders, you know, if you're a member of the board of directors. What this law would say that no, if you're a big company making $1 billion or more, you now have we're gonna basically supplement the fiduciary duty under state law and create a new legal federal duty that you have to consider all the stakeholders and you have to document that before you make a big decision. You know, it's not just about the shareholders. It's about the employees. It's about, you know, everybody else, suppliers, creditors, whoever might be a relevant stakeholder. You know, that could vary from company to company, you know, the environment, you know, if you have operations that could have a negative impact. And then thirdly, and this is to me is the most innovative aspect of the bill. It kind of modeled after what's going on in Germany. In Germany, the big companies have to have workers on the board of directors. What this bill would do is it would say the shareholders, 40% of the board of directors would be set aside for non-management employees, you know? So shareholders could elect up to, or at least I should say at least, it could be more, but at least 40% of the board of directors has to be, basically, daily non-management employees. And so it would give employees a voice on the board of directors. Basically, it's giving us, it's answering that part of that critique I just made. It's saying, look, employees, we're going to assign you a 40% weight, you know? And then the other ones, okay, we'll let the companies be more flexible on that. But at the very least, employees get a 40% weight, you know? They're going to have a voice on the board of directors. Notice they're not going to be a majority. That's why, you know, you can say the bill maybe stops short of you know, worker revolution kind of thing. But it at least gives employees a voice. If you allow me to end the lecture, I just want to show you something that's really, really interesting, is the current board of directors of Facebook. And then we'll conclude and open it up for questions and answers. Let me do this. I think I've got to go into my, I closed it by accident. I apologize, but I should be able to pull it up. Yeah, here we go. I'll do a screen share and show you Facebook's, that actually, one of the cool things about Facebook, there's so many, I wish I could have a third lecture where I could talk about some of the new things that Facebook is doing. So to their credit, this new oversight board, in fact, it's kind of like an appellate board. It's an independent agency that's fully funded by Facebook, but independently appointed. And they can veto, take down decisions that Facebook made. So right now, you know, when Facebook made that dramatic decision to kick President Trump off the platform, you remember Twitter was for 12 hours. Then Zuckerberg said, no, it's going to be permanent. And then Twitter said, yeah, we're going to do this indefinite. Well, that was now referred to the oversight board. And the oversight board will have the final word whether Trump can be let back on the Facebook and Instagram platforms. My understanding, I think he's being let on in the meantime while this appeal process goes on. But no, this is completely private. It's not a legal, you know, it's just a complete private ordering. So there's a lot, Facebook's doing a lot of cool things. But one of the other things I like about Facebook is that they're at least very transparent when it comes to corporate governance. I'll just show you their corporate governance page. And yeah, I have it pulled up right here. And you can pull it up yourself. It's just Facebook. You just Google Facebook corporate governance and this page should come up on top. And you can see all of the relevant legal documents. Now, you don't need to look at this for this class. We're not going to that level of detail. That would be more for a law school class where we look at some of these clauses. I just want to give you a big picture of how Facebook transmogrified, how it changed from a proprietorship to a partnership, then an LLC in Florida, then a Delaware Corp. But what's really cool is here you have a little bio of the management team. You can see, you know, I don't mean to be, you know, critical race theory. You can see it's all white. But, you know, to Facebook's credit, there's Sheryl Sandberg's up there, you know, number two, right? But that's the management team right there. Both Mark and Sheryl are on the board of directors. And then below this is you have the full board of directors, you know, in addition to, you can look at their backgrounds as well. And I'll say to Facebook's credit, they have a pretty diverse board. You know what I mean? A lot more diverse than Apple and, you know, a lot of these other companies. But one of the things you were not going to see on Facebook's board of directors, and I don't mean to pick on Facebook, because it's true of Apple, it's true of Google. In fact, it's true of every single, company that would qualify under the Accountable Capitalism Act, you know, whether it's privately or publicly owned. You rarely, if at all, you never see a worker, a rank and file worker on the board of directors. What you see is some people from the management team, and then you'll see a bunch of these like big shots, you know, university presidents, you know, titans of industry, you know, Elon Musk, all these powerful people, you know, former politicians. You never really see ordinary workers on the board of directors. And there's nothing really, Delaware law is nothing preventing that, you know? Board of directors, anybody could be, the shareholders elect the board of directors, you know? But the way it works out in practice is that the board of directors will make a recommendation to the shareholders, and the shareholders basically usually accept that recommendation of who's gonna be on the board, you know? And so what, you know, again, if you're for the Accountable Capitalism Act, one of the things I like about the bill, maybe it's not a good bill, you know, maybe it would go too far, maybe it would do more harm than good. But what I like about it perversely, not from a political perspective, is that it would force all of these so-called, you know, progressive liberal companies to put their money where their mouths are. It would, you know, and to say, well, if you're so progressive, go ahead, put some workers on your board of directors, you know, just stop talking about corporate social responsibility, stop talking about the stakeholder model and actually do it, you know, but consumer groups, you know, think of the UCF board of trustees, right? The student body president is on the board of trustees. There's a student representation on the board of trustees, you know? So the idea is that, now, again, I'm not saying I'm for the bill because it's two different questions, you know? What is a company's ethical responsibility? Is it the Friedman Doctrine, make as much money as possible within the confines of the law? I'm going to be honest, realistically, that's what all companies do, even though they say they're, you know, they say they're stakeholder, or should it be the stakeholder model? And if it should be the stakeholder model, then should we legislate that the way Senator Warren is proposing? Again, you might be for the stakeholder model as being, you know, much more inclusive, right? And looking at all the groups that a company affects when it makes a decision, but you may not be for legislating, right? For actually changing the law, you know, and changing this whole thing overnight. Or you may say, yeah, I'm tired of all this cheap talk. I'm tired of companies saying they're progressive and they care about their workers and customers. And then you look at their board of directors and they're either, you know, very few women, very few minorities on this kind of stuff, and zero workers, you know? So I don't think the Accountable Capitalism Act will be enacted anytime soon. It's probably too strong right now, but you know what? I wouldn't be surprised if I should at least get a fair hearing, you know? And I wouldn't be surprised if, you know, in the next presidential election cycle, you know, when the younger people, you know, start running for national office, or if Senator Warren herself has more success running for national office, I would not be surprised if this is back on the table and has a much more serious chance of getting approved. You know, whether it should be approved or not, it's a whole other question. But at least the bill, I'll say this in its defense, it forces us to think about business ethics and whether, you know, we just want to leave it as it is, which is the Friedman Doctrine with everybody pretending to be about, you know, stakeholders. Or do we really want to legislate the stakeholder model? Or do you just want to leave it voluntary, you know? And then if you want to be a benefit corporation, some states allow that. If you want to, you know, just make money, as long as you're within the law, just allow that as well. So, again, there's really no right answer. I want to show you that the law evolves, right? And that people, we have an input in the law, and, you know, politics can infect the law. You even saw how Trump made a big impact on the stakeholder model back in 2016 when he lobbied for workers of Carrier and Ford Motor Company and other companies. All right, so that's going to close our lecture number 5. You know, we've seen now, we've done a lot. You know, this actually we'd normally do this over several weeks, but now you've seen the 4 main ways of doing business, right? The sole proprietorship, the general partnership, the limited liability company, and the corporation, whether it's public or private, right? You saw that Facebook embodies at one point in its history each of these major forms of doing business. And now we've also seen the ethical side of corporate governance. We've seen that, you know, independent of a company, you know, of a fiduciary duties and the type of business entity a company chooses to do business under, you know, should it be about making money or should it be about, you know, stakeholders? And if it should be about stakeholders, should we legislate that as the Accountable Capitalism Act would purport to do if it were to be enacted? So we've actually done a lot, but I think you have a good big picture of corporate governance. And if you want to explore that further, you know, we can do that in an upper level advanced topics class that I teach, or you can do that on your own as well, depending on, you know, where life takes you and, you know, in your own personal research interests. Now with that, let me go ahead, because I do have I'm going to go ahead and conclude and just open it up to question and answer any questions, comments, or concerns. I'll stop the recording and you are free now to just, take off if you want to, as this now concludes the formal lecture on corporate governance.